a journey of Jesus. Actually, Jesus' pilgrimage from Galilee, the place where he grew up, the place where he started his ministry, and did a great deal of teaching and a great deal of his great works, his miracles, his healings. And in the 9th chapter of St. Luke's Gospel, Luke tells us, and this is sort of Luke's artistry. Jesus traveled a lot more. But Luke tells us, towards the end of the 9th chapter, he says, Jesus began to set his foot firmly on the road to Jerusalem. And everything between chapter 10 and chapter 19, which we read tonight, takes place on that journey, on that pilgrimage. Like Chaucer's pilgrims, Jesus and his disciples, a lot of things happened to them. Jesus encountered a lot of different people. He worked wonders. He taught sometimes very difficult things, the things that we would just as soon sort of pass over and pretend like, well, he didn't really mean that. And he taught some of those things that are wonderful and central to our own best spirit of Christianity, because right in there he gives the Lord's Prayer. Now, our gospel that we heard this evening, he is just at the end of that pilgrimage. And he enters the town of Jericho. He was probably traveling a lot down the Jordan River Valley, which, as we know, is well under sea level, rather hot and oppressive. He comes to one of the most ancient cities in the world, Jericho. They have archaeological traces going back, showing that it was a civilized city at the time when almost everybody else in the world were hunter-gatherers, 11,000 years ago. And it's been in constant habitation since that time. It has become the symbol for the Jewish people of their entry into the Promised Land. Gosh, if it's the battle of Jericho, 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 that's all about it. There's no archaeological evidence that that actually ever happened. But it certainly is central to Jewish consciousness, that story in the Bible, that was the first conquest that the Israelite people made to fulfill the promise of God that they would have their own land. And so it's a fairly significant city. It's an important city in part because it's an oasis in an otherwise desert that has a stream running through it that you can get some water for irrigation, but it's fed actually, Jericho is fed by springs that come out of the mountains that are very nearby, that you have to climb, and you find that those mountains are not mountains at all. They are the walls of the valley leading to the plateau where Jerusalem is on. So in other words, you climb up the mountain, but you never get to the other side. You go up to Jerusalem, and then you are kind of at the pinnacle. So Jesus was just about to embark on that last week of his life. Right after the incident that we have tonight will be Palm Sunday. So that's the significance of this conclusion of Jesus' pilgrimage. And as I say, you read through the Gospel of of Luke. And I would suggest, perhaps, that you do that. Take a couple of days to do that. And just walk with Jesus on that pilgrimage that culminates now with Zacchaeus and his coming into Jericho. So, what happens here? Well, all of the events of a pilgrimage are meant in some ways to focus on some little or big aspect of our lives to help us with the overall journey of life. A pilgrimage really is a microcosm of the macrocosm of our lives. So it kind of distills our lifetime journey into a relatively brief journey. And the events of that pilgrimage, you know, it's not just getting from point A to point B. The events of that pilgrimage, the journey itself, is one of growth, of healing, of development, of anticipation in what will be the final outcome. So Jesus comes into the city, and many people are waiting for him, but there's one particular unexpected person there. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. Now, that doesn't mean he was somebody respectable like all IRS agents are. He was instead what historians would call, sociologists would call, a tax farmer. He was delegated by the Roman government, the occupying Roman government, to collect the taxes of the city. By the way, Jericho was fairly wealthy because, as an oasis, they grew a lot of exotic plants there, including balsam. And balsam, the word balm comes from that. That was a resin that was a source of a lot of exotic perfumes, myrrh, all of those kinds of things that could command a real high price in the Roman market throughout the Roman Empire. So it was a pretty wealthy town. And the wealth of that town was the field for Zacchaeus to farm to get the taxes. Now, he was required, responsible for paying a certain percentage of the town's wealth to the Roman power. He was responsible for doing that. But he could collect any amount that he wanted from the people who had to pay. Which meant, of course, you know, when you're farming, you want to get as much as you can without destroying the source of what you're getting. So, you know, he had to leave enough for people basically not to be too inclined to rise up in revolt against him. Of course, he had his own army, which he could afford, to just be sure that people didn't rise up in revolt against him. You might imagine that would not make him the most popular of people in Jericho. Tax collectors were regarded by the religious Jews as the lowest of the low, right down there with prostitutes. The thing with both tax collectors and prostitutes was that they were seen as being locked in their sin. There was no way for them to get out of the sinful life that they were leading. Zacchaeus, of course, does show a way. Now, notice, and I think this is really important for us, in this last encounter before the end of Jesus' pilgrimage, before his arrival in Jerusalem, he Say it's the chaos in the sycamore tree. It's probably trying to hide. Just wanted to see, it's curiosity. Oops, better not fall. And Jesus sees him and he says, Zacchaeus, come down. I must stay at your house. Now notice, he didn't simply say, I want to stay at your house. He said, I must stay at your house. He didn't really give Zacchaeus a lot of choice, but it was a surprising command because nobody would have expected Jesus to say, I've got to stay at the house of the town crook. But that's what he did. That's what he did. Notice what we would probably say. At our best, we would say, like the best of the televangelists, Zacchaeus, you straighten out and maybe God will forgive you. And if you really straighten out, maybe I'll come and have dinner with you. Your treat, of course. But Jesus didn't say that. We would. Televangelists would. But Jesus actually said, I am going to stay at your house. Now, it's in that moment where Zacchaeus was able to say yes. That's when a transformation happened. And notice, Zacchaeus did really have a choice. He could have said, no way, go somewhere else. Jesus would have probably obeyed. But Zacchaeus obeyed Jesus when he said, I'm going to stay at your house. At that moment, a change of heart came. Now, I want to kind of finish up by telling you a little bit about what the terms of that change of heart actually were. Zacchaeus was fabulously wealthy. Wealthy enough to have a mansion in the suburbs, probably. Wealthy enough to have command of an army to extort the tax payments out of the people. He was extremely wealthy. And here's what he says he will do. Let me just get it right. My memory is going here. Okay. Half my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. Okay, in other words, everything that I have right in half, I'm going to give to the poor. Okay. Then he says, and if I have defrauded anyone, ha ha. Probably defrauded everyone. But I will repay them fourfold. Well, maybe he had that kind of money to be able to promise that. But what to me is very, very clear is given his lifestyle, given his situation, given his occupation, what he was saying is, I am reducing myself to total nothingness. I am reducing myself to poverty. To make that promise and to fulfill it would not leave much of anything, if anything at all, back for himself. Now, the story does end there, with, of course, Jesus' comments about coming to save the lost. Tradition takes up the story. Tradition has it that at that point, Zacchaeus did leave everything and began to follow Jesus, became one of Jesus' disciples. And tradition has it that he ended up being the bishop, the apostle, the evangelizer, and the bishop of Caesarea, which was a port town, port city on the Mediterranean coast. And so that conversion was a complete one. Now it's interesting, at the end of this pilgrimage, the real end of the pilgrimage of Jesus is the cross, right? And the resurrection. But the last act that he does on the pilgrimage is to heal a hardened sinner in a way that this sinner does the same thing that Jesus did on the cross. Give up everything. So, with that, with Chaucer and his pilgrims in mind, with the pilgrimage of Jesus as depicted in St. Luke's Gospel and the culmination of that pilgrimage in Jericho, let's think for a moment about the pilgrimage that Jesus is calling us, inviting us on. Because, and this will be my very last sentence, because that pilgrimage says something about our commitment to discipleship, which is also what stewardship, which you're going to hear a lot about in the next couple of weeks. Don't cringe. Well, maybe cringe, because Jesus asks a lot of us, and stewardship asks a lot of us. And we can have the generosity to give what he asks in following him only when we let him touch us and touch us deeply.
I believe in one God.